theories, techniques, achieving things which people don't think women can achieve. And we want to break those ideas, we want to break those barriers for everyone and highlight such achieving women and their contribution to science, and hence this mission of Women in Science. So with this, I'll hand you over to Dr. Nishima again. She will introduce the speaker. Okay. Dr. Nishima, please.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. So with your permission, ma'am, before introducing Anuradha, ma'am, can I just play a video of ma'am just to give an introduction about a very short 2-minute video to show our audience what her life is all about? Thank you. I'll just start it.
I am Anuradha. I am Program Director at Indian Space Research Organization. From childhood, I have been interested in mathematics and science. All the participations I used to have was all debates, essays. I would say I was not a naughty girl. At home also, we had an open atmosphere. I had a lot of freedom, but it wasn't so with many of my friends too. We had a mixed group, and we used to have study circles, we would study, etc. But there were girls who shied away from that. See, it's not that you have to mix with a boy or a girl. The wider your circle, the wider your professional knowledge update would be happening. It was the landing on Moon in 1969 which really scintillated my imagination. That really opened up that this is something beyond. When I became the first woman project director in ISRO, it was for me a gradual step. Once the launch was over, it became such a thing that the first lady project director, when they started publicizing in the newspapers, then they said, oh wow. When I had my first child, you know, those days, the maternity leave was only for 90 days. So when you had to go back to office, a lot of adjustments had to be done at that time. Myself and my husband, we have grown almost together in our career. The bringing of children is not just my responsibility, it has been his too. Even when they are ill or they need some special attention, we have always divided our responsibilities. My advice to young girls, if you want to do something, it will happen. Girls, keep your focus very clear what you want to do. Don't get distracted on the path. And don't get biased by other cues. What you think is right, you please go ahead on that line.
Okay. So, with this, I would like to introduce ma'am. So it's often said that men are from Mars while women are from Venus. But following the success of the Mars mission, many dub Indian women scientists as the women from Mars. So I just love this statement. So I just picked it up and told it. Okay. So our speaker for today, Mrs. T.K. Anuradha, she's one dynamic woman who not only debunked myths surrounding women's lack of inclination towards fields related to science, but she has also risen to the topmost position of India's space agency. She joined ISRO in 1982 and has been working since then. In fact, she is the first woman director at ISRO. Born in Karnataka in 1961, she graduated with a bachelor's degree in electronics from the University Visvesvaraya College of Engineering in Bangalore. In fact, it was like she has mentioned in the video also, it was Neil Armstrong's landing on the moon that fascinated her a lot. She had no television during those days, but got to know about it from her parents and teachers, who actually encouraged her a lot. She actually once said, "It really ignited my imagination. I wrote a poem on a man landing on the moon in Kannada, my native language." And she was, I think, I read it somewhere, she was just 9 years old at that time, and she wrote this poem. He has played a pivotal role in developing and launching ISRO communication satellite GSAT-12 into space from the Satish Dhawan Space Center on 15 July 2011. Besides that, she also has led the technical group of 20 engineers working for the same. In September 2012, she led the launch of GSAT-10. As the project director at ISRO, she supervised the launch of the GSAT-9, GSAT-17 and GSAT-18 communication satellites. She has also worked in the capacity of project manager, deputy project director and associate project director for the Indian Remote Sensing and the Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System programs. And her advice for aspiring female scientists is, she says, women aspiring to become rocket scientists need to make domestic arrangements. She is in fact the quintessence of what one becomes when one let one's inner child dream and pursue what one wants. Hats off to you, ma'am. I won't take much time and we are really waiting to hear from you, and I'll give it over to you, ma'am, to our speaker, Professor T.K. Anuradha. Please, ma'am, please begin with your lecture. Thank you, ma'am.
We can ask all of you. Just a minute, ma'am. I think we can ask everyone to mute and take their videos off.
Yes, please. Please mute your microphones and switch off your video so that you can fully listen to our speaker's presentation. Thank you so much.
Very good afternoon, Professor Archana Bhatnagar and dear Dr. Nishima. You have all been very kind to give a wonderful background about me, and sometimes I wonder it was me. Okay, so it's a past, it's done, and I'm really happy with all of you and the wonderful research related people today who have assembled there, maybe students, research assistants and all the concerned members from Punjab University. I wish in better times I would have taken a flight and come and met you all in live, and you know the circumstances are making us do this way, but not bad at all. We can still be meeting each other. That's great. So thanks once again for the kind introduction. Then I have a small presentation I would like to do that. See, actually when I was talking to Professor Bhatnagar and also to Nishima what I should be talking about, so it was interesting that many things could be brought in together, but at the same time, I have made my concept in such a way that I will tell you about my organization, because there's a kind of a bond that I identify myself with ISRO. Okay, so I understand that when I am trying to tell you about ISRO, it's about telling about myself. That's the way it is, and how a career can grow and what should be the way we have to take up so that one can think of leadership activities in an organization. But it is not more than a person. I think it is an organization also which contributes in a big way. So it is a story which is symbiosis of me and the organization together. So when I am trying to tell you this story, you can see yourself. How do I fit into this? Kindly bear with me for about 20 minutes. So what are the key factors? I just wanted to, whatever came to my mind, I wanted to put it together with all of you to share with you. Let me just get out of this notification. Yes. Key factors, what should be in a leader as a person or as an organization? All of us should have definitely a vision, a goal, and a commitment. And in the process, we have to keep doing innovations. I'll tell you why we have to. And finally, the results matter. And in the whole journey, you must have adventures. And you must have partnerships. You're not an island. So there are many such good, in any leadership book or anything, you can see it, but I'm trying to put through my experience. So finally, what is the integration of these keys is that one will get an ownership and pride in what they are doing, where they belong. And it also develops a culture within you, which is essential for success. So let us try to, let me just tell you about ISRO. The wonderful vision which the father of space in India, Vikram Sarabhai, gave us was that we were already, you know, when we started our space business in 1969, there were giants, there were space, you know, ventures which were going on in the Cold War time, and already America had landed on moon, and they were doing wonderful things. Russia had put a man, and such was a competition fiercely going on. And look at the vision which Sarabhai brought to us. If we have to play a meaningful role nationally and in the community of nations, we must be second to none in the application of the advanced technologies for the problems of man and society. So he looked towards back on Earth, on our nation, our requirements. There are a lot of technologies which are developing and they are progressing. How do we bring that so that our lifestyle improves, our life in India improves? How do we do that? That was the great vision with which we started. So this vision has to be translated into goals. So the goals, we rooted it firm in very simple things. We started simple, everything. We started our launches with simple sounding rockets. We started our satellites for communication with a very, very basic experiment called Apple. That was Ariane passenger payload experiment. And a small satellite called Bhaskara, which gave us a lot of understanding about what remote sensing should be. And navigation, we started putting some payloads in some satellites, trying to understand. And despite all that, our exploratory missions to Moon, Mars, etc., have never died, because that is what lives inside the culture of a scientist. You have to explore, you have to understand. Why we have not deviated from our vision that we have to bring the applications back to mankind, how we are doing that. So if you see that over the years, every stream has grown so big. Today we are proud in each of these streams, and India is very proud of that. So commitment, I told you, is the next key. What is very important for a commitment? So if you see that, every leader has to do, he has to take that position that, you know, there is a beautiful shloka in Sanskrit. If I just translate, it means that whatever the leader, you know, performs, rest of the people will do the same thing. Whatever the leader vouches for, the rest of the team will commit to that and they will do in the same manner. So it's essential that the leader of an organization, or if you're leading your life, you are the leader. What is it? How you have to go the right path and think ahead and do. Be a visionary. That is very important. That kind of commitment, when it is there, you have to do what you say. And you have to be exemplary in your lifestyle. That is what will make the rest of the members also follow the same thing. And the importance of innovation, I cannot tell in any short time at all. Innovation was absolutely essential for us because we had very limited resources. In the limited resources, how do we make our dreams come true? So that is where innovation started mattering. And also it became a way of survival for us. We were not able to get every technology from outside. Nobody was ready to give it to us. They were thinking we were just, you know, making fun and playing around with space. And they were also probably afraid that if we give the technology, they may grow bigger than us. So all these things and whatever they have learned, we had to do many things, inventing the wheels and learn too. But it's not a bad idea. We did it. So it was a way to survive. If you have to meet your vision with your goals, we had to survive and then make sure that we bring innovations. Some people even have called it as jugaad. You might have heard the word jugaad, right? Going to Mars, they called it as jugaad, but we didn't go, right? So that is the thing. I just want to give you a few examples of the innovation. Whatever is the problem, we have never stopped. So what you're seeing is very iconic. The rocket parts and the satellite being transported on whatever is available, you know, in the olden days, about nearly half a century back, how we were working. But this only iconic, but it also shows a commitment, a determination that come what may, we are going to do, we are going to have a solution. This is some of the simplest thing, but we had a bigger obstacles. Bigger obstacle was subsequent to Pokhran. We were denied of technology by all these forward nations. And, you know, that was a blessing in disguise for us. And we circumvented the challenge and we brought up our own indigenous designs in terms of antenna, hardware, memory elements. That was a fantastic time. I'm really proud that I was part of that satellite, technology experiment satellite. So we wanted to prove all those indigenous technology ourselves and then make sure that they are working for our bigger dreams to come forward later on. So this is another very interesting example I want to tell you about the navigation, how ISRO brought out a solution. See, for example, you can see on the right-hand side, a GPS satellite. All of you are aware, all your telephones have the GPS and location, you get very easily, all that stuff. And you know, that GPS satellite constellation is highly complex.
Sorry to interrupt. Ma'am, are you shifting the slides? Because what we can see is your first slide.
I'm shifting the slide. You were not able to see?
No, we are actually seeing your title slide.
Yeah, I thought also the same.
Okay, now what do we do about it? Just give me a minute, okay?
Please go to slideshow and press slide.
I am in slideshow actually.
Oh, but we can't see it like that.
Because what I was thinking that probably you are on the first slide and but
I now you are able to see the second slide.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, now we see Dr. Vikram Sarabhai. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
That means I cannot go to slideshow mode. I will go this way only then.
Okay, ma'am.
That's okay, ma'am.
That's fine.
Probably I can just slightly increase the size.
That's okay, ma'am. I think we are able to read it. So yeah, it should be okay.
You're able to read it, right? So we'll try to do that. One second.
Yeah, so you're on the third slide, ma'am. We can see that.
Yeah, we are on the third slide.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
True. Okay. So there's a way to minimize all this thing, na? I don't know.
Ma'am, if you go down on the right, towards right-hand side, there is this icon. Ma'am. Right, yeah.
Yes, this is the
one. Yeah, the ma'am. You were just there.
No, ma'am. To the right.
The one next. Yes, I think it's come.
You are able to see that now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So you are able to see this?
Yes.
Yeah.
So this is what I was trying to tell you, that we have four stream satellites and all. It has grown big. I was trying to tell you about the goal. And another important key was the commitment set by example by the leaders. I was trying to tell you, are you able to see that?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then we'll go in this mode. So I told you why innovations are essential, and the iconic thing of transporting the rockets and the satellite on very humble manner is really a kind of a reminder to us always in our lives that any challenge we have to face. And I was telling you about our navigation satellite system, where GPS satellites, you can see it's a highly complex system where 24 satellites, they are giving service all around the globe. Then why did we have to do our own navigation system? You might have heard of NAVIC or IRNSS satellites. Why did we have to do it? Because the main purpose was not to, of course, secondary offshoots of putting it in your mobile phone and all. This was required essentially for our services, where, you know, whenever we had very important event, the GPS, there used to be a dith ring and you don't get accurate information. So such was the capability. And if you also remember, GPS signals were not available to an aircraft and we lost the aircraft. Since then, a lot of things have happened, that Malaysian aircraft, etc. So every country wants to become self-reliant with regard to navigation, a very simple solution was brought by ISRO that we have to give solution to our region. So just with 7 satellites and with very less dynamics, we could make that happen. So that is one of the innovations we are very proud of. And another interesting thing is we don't have gigantic rockets with us. At least now we have JSLV Mark III. We had our simple PSLV, which took us from low Earth orbits to geo orbits, 36,000 kilometers to Moon, to Mars. And we also set a record for carrying 104 satellites at a time, which was broken only a couple of days back by SpaceX. You know, so with a simple rocket, we could do so much. Innovation means taking it to stretch as much as possible. What is the best you can do with the available resources? So how did we do? We did that with a lot of innovation in our software and in our flight dynamics, the path in which you have to take so that you can still carry what you want to carry on the small rocket and go. So these are some of the challenges which were very successfully met. Okay, all these are not for just having to say that I did it. But finally, the achievements are the proof. Proof is in the pudding. You have to show to people that our vision, that we have brought the applications back to ground. What do we have to do? So all our efforts have to be finally culminated into the results. And also induce a confidence by the country, confidence by the government who is financing us that yes, I should encourage them further that they can do these applications. So what did we do? Let us take the technology. Today, if you take technology, space, we are self-reliant. I'm not telling self-sufficient. There is a lot of difference between self-reliance and self-sufficiency. So if you see these astonishing numbers, 320 satellites from other countries we have launched, and so many rockets we have made, so many satellites, 111 satellites we have made, etc. So today we are self-reliant that other countries are looking at us as their partners. Yes, there is something India can give it to us, so I can also give it to them. So we are on a platform where we can handshake with them. So that was a very important thing in terms of technology ISRO could achieve, self-reliance. Nobody can be self-sufficient in space. Everybody cannot do everything, but we should be able to get the confidence of others that there will be a mutual give and take. Today we are able to achieve that on the technology front. And what did we do for this? All homemade recipes. So we built a lot of infrastructure. We have space transportation center, launch center, and we can make hardware. We can develop the software. All the required facilities are available with us. Critical technologies we have mastered, like cryo engines for the rockets, is extremely critical. Simply the optics for the cameras, communication systems. Today, we are even doing atomic clocks for the required for the navigation. All these systems, subsystems, how do we do with along with the industry in India? So there was an industrial growth and there is a lot of job opportunities which were generated directly at ISRO or ISRO dependent industries. Overall, there was a national progress because of all these applications. So this is on the technology. So if you see the application, what Vikram Sarabhai dreamt, how did we bring the application? How did we do the walking the talk? We kept telling that we are going to make our lives better. Today, space is ubiquitous. Every part of our life, space has got interlinked because of ISRO's efforts. If you see the agriculture, there has been a wonderful development that even to a small agricultural plot, we can tell what exactly is the turnout and what is the crop yield which is going to come, or an early warning of certain diseases which are coming. So which has helped the activity, and also for the government tools to manage all the agricultural crops when they are coming up, how to manage assessment and how to distribute it. It has been a departments, agricultural departments are extensively using that. Fisheries, fishermen are much, much safe today. So in terms of where to catch the fish, where
it is available. They come back empty-handed. And at the same time, they also have the safety with regard to the instruments provided to them, that when they are lost, all they have to do is just press a button and satellites will link it back and locate them where they are and we bring them back. Such applications are there. And disasters. Disaster management is one thing which is going wonderfully well. Disasters, of course, no satellite can stop. But disaster management is something we have been doing very efficiently. Nowadays, we hardly hear the lives which are, or the cattle which are dead, or the livestock which is gone because of the disasters. But the forewarning and moving the people, government is amply aided by that, whether it is forestry, forest firing, and drought estimation, drought reliefs, and even the glacier movements, town planning, watershed management. Apart from that, even every day you go home and switch on your TV, the entertainment that you are getting, that DTH satellites, whether it is Tata Sky or Reliance or whoever is giving all the services, so you are getting through our satellites. And today our stock exchanges and the whole economy is going on through the satellite links everywhere. So I don't know how many of you have observed, go to an ATM and just see on the top, there will be an antenna. So how is it that I can go to Timbuktu and draw money from my home branch? That is because of the satellite links. So that is what is a proof we have given, that that is the way. Space has become part and parcel of each and everybody's life today. Apart from that, as I told, adventures are required. You have to be bold. You have to do things. Stretch the limits to see what you can do, because we have to understand the universe too. Bringing the technology to common man today is one thing. For the common man in the future is another thing. For that, we need to understand the universe in a big way. So a lot of good things have happened. I hope you are able to see this slide, Chandrayaan 1 slide. It was almost a decade back, that first step when we had to say hello to Moon. When we went there, it was fantastic. It was the Chandrayaan 1 which showed the traces of water on Moon which was available. And our own software was validated and our flight methods were validated, that we can go beyond Earth's gravity and do that. And Indian and international experiments were put. Even US, Europe, all of them put their experiments in our small satellite and we could take it on our PSLV. And a small probe which went, spinning over the moon and fell on the moon had Indian flag on it, that we called as the Moon Impact Probe. Moon Impact Probe gave us a very wonderful information about the water possibilities in the deep crevices on the moon there. And then we didn't want to, keep quiet at that. Can we go beyond? Moon is, after all, part of the Earth system. Moon is going around us. Can we go beyond Earth's influence at all? Yes, we could do that. That was a great technology demonstration. And we have wonderful pictures of Mars. Entire Mars has been mapped. And that was a wonderful learning for us in terms of how to bring in automation, how to manage the thermal, everything, communication. Take any subject, it gave us a lot of lesson in that one. And further, we wanted to be more adventurous. A couple of years back, we wanted to put our one lander on the surface of the moon and put a rover also. But all of you might have seen that the lander could not survive the impact, and we could not do that. But the lessons learned were great. And we are going to do very soon. Because of the pandemic condition, last year we could not do, otherwise we would have really been successful by this time. And I'm especially proud of one small thing what we have put, AstroSat. You know, a lot of huge telescopes are put in the sky by America, Russia, Europe, and all that. So each one of them is doing a wonderful job and they are giving us a lot of information. But in our own way, we contributed in a unique manner. So I don't know how many of you are physics students there. See, the information we get is in different spectrum range. So each of these huge telescopes are generally in particular spectral range. So we put a multi-wavelength thing in a small satellite, you know, which is highly, it does a dance in the sky. It first detects some event, it keeps on looking at it. And once the event occurs, it will immediately move all the payloads that side and capture. And some of the best information about the far-off galaxies, we were able to get through this. And all the nations are continuously using our AstroSat data. And we are not, satisfied. Very soon we are sending, even that satellite should have gone last year. This year it will be going. We have a program called Aditya. It is another wonderful thing that it doesn't, you know, either go to the sun or it won't remain with the earth. There is a point called Lagrange point where the gravities will equalize somewhat. So that we put the satellite there and work. It's a wonderful experiment which we are planning out. So I hope it will be a great event for us. So how did we do all that? As I told, no organization is an island. We should not work that way. Networking is absolutely essential. We need to take everyone along with us. So how did we go about? It was all the government bodies, which are, of course, using our utilizing and giving their requirements so that we can develop further technologies. Academia, lot of academic institutes are there with us and they do the research for us and they do small experiments for us. And private sectors are helping us in a big way, private and public sectors, in building a lot of parts of satellites and the rocket. Today, in fact, you know, you believe it or not, nearly 85% of the hardware of rockets are not made within ISRO. It is made by the private industries. So you just imagine the amount of employments it has created, amount of technology development it has happened, material technologies that has happened. And finally, the international cooperations, which is absolutely essential. See, everywhere we cannot be inventing the wheel. So we have to cooperate. To cooperate, we have to be at a level where we can shake hands, as I already told. Today, we are able to do that. So it is that inclusive way of development that is what is most important. And another key, which I'm coming to the end of my thing, is that culture. Culture is absolutely essential. So in the whole process, an organization has to develop a culture. So why the culture is required? You have to have a passionate working towards it. I never worked for ISRO because I'm getting my salary. I don't know whether salary came to the bank or not. Of course, we need to meet our daily things. But the organization has to feed such an excitement and adventure and commitment from us that a passion comes. And you're doing just like that I do at home for my family members, I do for the office. That kind of culture has to come. And another important thing for a scientific organization like ISRO, for example, I think it is truth, either scientific or non-scientific, is continuous learning. If we stop learning, we die. Whether personally or as an organization, we die if there is no learning. So the importance of culture could not be told better, as told by one Mr. Weitzel, who is a corporate bigwig, and he was there in the talent search teams and all that. You can have the right strategy in the world, but if you don't have the right culture, you are dead. So that culture is essential, because culture will make not only you, you are never alone. A culture is essential to bond everybody together so that we achieve together what has to be done. So within the organization, I must tell you that there is enabling of each and every employee. So the treatment of the employee is very important. Nourishing the leadership is important. Nourishing the leadership not based on the gender or caste or creed or language or anything, that kind of openness. And you have to give everybody a space. I would like to give a small example that in ISRO, even if he's the tiniest technician, he'll become the leader when he has a skill that has to be applied at a particular event. Even the chairman or the director of the event will be sitting there and listening to him, and he's the leader. So the leadership doesn't mean the position. Leadership is by the function and the skill a person has. So at that moment, who is the leader? We have to keep identifying, and we cannot have egos that I'm senior to him or her, and he has to listen to me. Then nothing will come out. So the openness, that kind of atmosphere, you know, that is what has made a lovely environment. Why I'm telling is, please keep relating it back to your personal life too. So even in the family, we must have such an environment. Somehow I feel an organization is like a family, you know. So, and your role, how you manage things around in the office, essential that you do in a similar way at home. Okay, so that psychological contract has to be there among all of us. That is the culture of an organization. Unfortunately, nowadays, I understand all the new companies and all that. Nobody cares. As long as I get my paycheck, I'm going. No, it doesn't work for long. They're all bubbles. If you want for a continued, consistent performance, a culture is required in the home, in the, you know, organization, etc. And another most important thing is, how do you handle failures? Nobody is successful 100% of the time, you know, in their life or in the organization or in their missions, etc. Failures do happen. But we have learned a big lesson from ISRO, that any failure has to be taken as a catalyst for further learning. We always come back from ashes like a phoenix and soar very high, because we have very strong introspections, reviews, analysis, and get the solution and fly back. Like I told, Chandrayaan lander failed. So we did not sit there crying. So the night the committee started working on it, there was a laboratory which was set up next. People did not sleep 3 months. We worked day and night. And we found out what could have gone wrong and how we should have strengthened, where was the weakness. And also taking the failures with equanimity, you know, the press or public, they can, of course, in case of Chandrayaan 2, we had the best support from the entire nation and internationally also, who appreciated everything. But still, there are events, you know, where we get a lot of brickbats, you know, and we should take it. And we also get bouquets when we are successful. So do not worry, we are not doing it for any of those things. So we want, our goal is very clear. We want to fly high. So we are looking at that and we keep strengthening. Every failure, in fact, is a blessing in disguise, that we learn much, much more. Complacency cannot set in when there are small failures, small setbacks. So that is our greatness. And I must tell you about ISRO. ISRO is a high learning organization. We call it as HILO, high learning organization, because it's a continuous learning. How did that culture come in? Continuous. That's what has made what ISRO is. That is what has made every ISROite, whoever it is, he or she. So by culture, knowledge-based leadership, a person becomes a leader not because of, as I already told, that he is senior or anything. No. A leadership happens with his skill, with his knowledge. So that is a culture that is very important. And if you want to be a leader, you need to improve yourself. And even the promotion policy emphasizes that we can grow only by learning. Our promotional interviews are really like, you know, worse than the engineering exams we had. So we have industry experts, academia experts, and all great seniors will be sitting with a lot of experience, and they grill you to know whether you have a potential to the next position. So in fact, the syllabus is anything and everything under the sky. So you have to know what you're working on, the depth of it. Along with that, you need to have the width of how you are related to the rest of the work which is going on. So promotion policies also ensure that there's a continuous learning. So what is the reward you get? Okay, you got promotion, what do you get? So more responsibility and work. The worthiness in ISRO is how much responsibility is put on you and how much you're working. So that is a reward. That is a person, oh, he's very good in office. That is the way it goes. And even in the project time, you know, it is very tough reviews. Every day it is a review. And every single thing will be questioned 100 times. And finally, the self-respect to us comes from peer respect. Peer respect comes when you are learned, when you are knowledgeable. And in the whole process, innovations are a must, and it is a way to survive for us, as I already told you. In fact, I just want to give you a small example. When I became project director for the first time, it was a tough time. You know, I had to be reading a lot at home and very extended hours in the office. My daughter once asked me, why do you want to become a project director? You could have been happy, you know, not being project director. Then it put me onto a thinking. Then I explained her, and you know, today, looking back, for whatever I did, I feel that my family members are proud of me. My office has recognized me enough. So on both the fronts, we could do it because I could pursue my passion. The passion pursuance is most important. You know, if you do not pursue and you give up, you will not be respected by your own children. You will be a pushover. Okay, if you can show them that you can stand and run extra mile and do what is demanded and still meeting every requirement, you know, without getting burned out, of course. You need to see that you are not burnt out and keep the capacity, eat well, do exercise, keep yourself fit. You know, those things are also important. Finally, the pride in you. Your life is, you know, your organization, you have pride. The, you know, country people have pride in ISRO, and I have pride in ISRO, and ISRO has pride in me. My family members have pride in me. So, you know, it's like it's small baby steps we took with 2 rupee note showing Aryabhata, and today 2,000 rupee notes, they have Mangalyaan on it. So that is the, you know, recognition and the pride the nation has shown us. So it's always there in your pockets. ISRO is there in your pockets. So the whole process, if you see this kind of, you know, if you have a passionate activity and profession, you think the success or the leadership, is it based on gender or culture? No, it is your inner strength, your inner learning. That's what matters for you to become a leader. We can give 100 reasons of why I'm not able to do, but you must have one reason why you have to do. That is enough. You must do that. You cannot tell, I'm now aged, I cannot do this. I have 2 kids, I cannot do this. No, nothing is going to work like that. You have to do if you want to do, if you have the passion to do. So that's what I would like to tell all of you. And I just wanted to keep the time limit. I hope I could do that. And if there are any questions, if I know the answer, I'll tell you. And you know, at ISRO, we know that we can't have answers for everything. We always know that. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for this wonderful lecture. And not only you told us about ISRO, but you also told us many such important things about how to lead our lives, actually, how to set high goals and fly high. And even if you fail, just rise like a phoenix. So interesting, ma'am, that have leadership with a skill and don't allow egos to come into the way. Very, very basic, but very important points, which are very important, as we can see from your example also. You're such a great scientist, yet you were so modest. You accepted our invitation. You gave our lecture here. You told us how to pursue our passion and not be a pushover, but with a tagline that without being burned out. And I really liked it when you said that ISRO is always there in our pockets as rupees 2,000 notes. Now I make sure that I have rupees 2,000 notes in my bag all the time. Okay. So if I can now request Dr. Jayanti Datta, ma'am, if she can take over for the question and answer session. Ma'am, if you're there.
Yes, yes. Thank you very much, Nishima.
Okay.
Thank you very much, Anuradha ma'am. I think you have already asked for questions. So our session is open now. People can ask questions to ma'am. And I also have one personal question to ask that maybe I'll take later on. Later on I'll ask. So first, yes, who would like to ask a question?
Dr. Jayanti, may I ask?
You can raise your hand. Yes, yes. Yes, Deepthi ma'am. Please go on, please.
Thank you, ma'am, for a very, very inspiring talk. And No, it's not a question, actually. I just wanted to compliment you. I was very happy with the flower at the end of the presentation. That is what women are about, you know. Our little gestures. If it had been a man, he would just have copied and pasted a flag. So I love the way you put the colors of the tricolor in the flower. And you made everyone aware that India is about all the genders, not just men. Wonderful, wonderful. I'm sorry, I don't have a question for you, because in this gathering of educated scientists, I belong to the humanities. So I look at things from the angle of culture. So that was my little contribution. And thank you.
Thank you.
Our invitation. We look forward to welcoming you physically here soon.
Yes, sure.
Thank you, Dr. Jayanti.
Yes, anybody else would like to ask something or comment?
Ma'am, there's a question in the chat box also by Alicia.
Yeah, I'll just check. Yes.
Can you read it out?
Yes, ma'am.
Alicia is asking, ma'am, that your work is commendable. She wants to know what will be your one piece of advice for working women for managing both household and their work. I think that is in everybody's mind all the time. Yes, please. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I know. Very, very justified question, actually. You know, this is the dilemma that starts in the minds of young women when they enter into, their lives with marriage and kids and all that. See, everybody, there is no single solution for this. Everybody has to find their own solution. For example, for me, the solution was that I decided not to be a nucleus family. So I always had my elders with me, and I could be carefree at least that there is nothing dangerous happening to my children and things like that. But that need not have to be the only solution. I know, as I was telling Aditya, the project director of Aditya is a close friend of mine, one lady, Nigar Shaji. And she had no help. She's from Kerala, and she was living in a nuclear family in Bangalore. And, you know, she managed wonderfully well taking external help. Of course, we need some help, because to ensure that the children are safe. But I must tell you one thing to reassure all the ladies, that all other children will grow up fine. If you set an example, just because you showed more interest in the office or you have to be involved more, it really doesn't mean that your children will go out of the way. No, it doesn't happen. If that is a destiny, it happens. I'm not telling destiny. If that is the way our family culture is, etc., it can happen whether you are working, not working. For many families, such a thing has happened even with housewives. Okay, so your priority should be the safety of the children and nourishment of the children, and they are getting good education, and you are there for them at the back. Especially in the modern time, you're always connected with your mobile phones and all that. You're connected. So please do not think that you feeding the kid or you yourself washing the kid is the only way the bonding happens, or that's the only way children will come to progress. No, I reassure you, all our children, whether we were in the nuclear families or we were in the joint families, our children have grown up to make all of us proud, and they are proud of us too. And they have grown up to be, responsible citizens. They understand what is sharing in the house. You know, they also have to share the responsibility, right? So all your children will come up well. Do not worry about it.
Thank you very much. I think this reassurance coming from you really means something. And I was also going to ask you about your personal journey, because you told us about ISRO. And I would just also like to tell you that whenever there is some event by ISRO, whether it is that moon event or any other event on which is broadcast, telecast on Doordarshan, my whole family sits together. We all sit together, whether it is at night or any time during the day. And it's really a very, I think, celebration for everybody to look at all those achievements of the country. I would just like to ask you that whether about, first of all, about what is your personal journey? How is your personal journey right from when you were a science student to this thing? And also, how much the culture of the institute actually helps, or how can we cultivate that culture of empower? I would not say empowering women, but my issue is that did you ever feel that you don't want to be a woman, or whether you felt like, because it's not a politically correct question to ask that whether you felt that you don't want to be a woman, but I would say, did you, it came to your mind that, because when I'm listening to you, you seem like any other scientist, whether it's a man or a woman, you seem like a scientist. This thing doesn't come to you, the identity of a woman doesn't overpowers that identity of a scientist. So I would just like to know these smaller layers of your journey.
Yes, sure. Actually, you know, first of all, my journey, we were four girls at home. We were all four daughters at home. And my parents were very liberal that, there was no restriction beyond the safety limit, of course. We had to be back home by 7 o'clock in the evening, mostly for the, safety point of view. But we had no restriction that you're a girl, don't do this, you're a girl, don't do that. No. In fact, they were pushing us that we have to be into everything, debates, essays, any competition, we would be there. And I still remember, I'm a very bad singer. And there was an event when the chief guest had not yet come. I was still a child there. I had gone with my parents. They just made a general announcement. Anybody who can come and sing because the chief guest is coming late. I thought it was a personal invitation to me. I just went out and I sang. It was so bad. Then I realized that my voice was shaking and all that. And my parents, they were smiling. They came. When I came down, I was ashamed, and they told, they were very proud of me that I made an attempt to that. If I want to learn singing, I can learn. Okay. So, I mean, parents play a big role in the life of any child, so they have to push them. And my parents never regretted that they had four daughters. We were like four pillars to our family. So, I don't know. I never felt that I must, celebrate I'm a woman. Or I never felt, why am I a woman? So both I never felt, I have been an equal wherever I've gone, whether in schools or colleges or the workplace. One thing is your own attitude matters, the way you are brought up. I know some of my colleagues, they're very shy and they don't participate because, they've been told like, you're a girl, you should not talk in front of others and, you have to keep. I mean, some families, they bring up like that. It all starts with that. One thing is what comes as a seed from the family. But as you grow, you are an individual. You also have to inculcate what is good and what is not good for you. You cannot keep blaming that my great-grandfather did something, so I am like that. No. I think personally, I don't know how many of you know Bhagavad Gita. Even in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that Udharet Atmanam Atmana. You have to help yourself. Nobody can come and help you. Not your parents, not your grandparents, nobody. So you must have the inspiration in yourself that I want to do something and I am fully capable. I have two legs, two hands, two eyes. I am also equal to everybody else. I must be able to do it, right? So you have energy and, all the time thinking from outside, what that fellow will think, who cares? What I think of myself is what mattered to me all the time. That's how I have come throughout. Maybe that attitude also helped me because maybe men also come up with certain, cultural, baggages and they may try to treat you differently in office. But when you don't care and they understand that, this is something different, it's a different species. So everything will be fine. So first stop worrying about what others say. That would be fine. Am I connected?
Yes, ma'am, you're very much yes, there. Dr. Yes. Jayanti, you can continue with it.
Jayanti, ma'am, are you there? I think
she's muted.
Yeah, she's muted.
Yeah, please switch on your microphone, ma'am. Jayanti, ma'am. Yeah, I think there's a problem with her connection. No problem.
So we can ask questions. Anybody has any questions, they can just unmute and ask, ma'am.
Yeah, please go ahead and unmute yourself and ask, ma'am. In fact, ma'am, you just rightly said that actually we should not care so much about what others are thinking. We should just go ahead and work with passion. Actually, what you just said, so true. Yeah. So actually, from you we can see actually, like you said, you were four sisters, but you never felt like there was you were girls and there was some shortcoming. Like that. So we can see that it depends upon with what kind of environment you have been given. Actually, initially during your initial years, what kind of environment you have. And later on when you are in that position, how you as a person, how you deal with your circumstances. Ah, you rightly said that it's up to you actually how you deal with it. Yeah. So, to the audience, if you have any other questions, somebody is having. Anuradha Swami says that thanks, ma'am. It was a great talk. I just want to say that every woman tries her best to manage things at workplace and home and many other spheres of life, and it feels great when we get appreciation for the same. This platform made me happy today to listen this discussion today. Okay, thank you, Anuradha.
Thank you.
Yeah. Also, you share actually your name with our speaker also.
Yes, I was going to say that.
I know, it's so, wherever I go, at least I'll have minimum three Anuradhas. In my office, there were seven Anuradhas. So.
And she's also actually my PhD student, Anuradha Swami. So that's how our connection is there. Okay. Yeah. Anybody else who wants to ask, you can unmute yourself.
Yeah, can I ask one question?
Yeah, sure. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am, it was a very nice talk and thank you very much for this inspirational talk. I was just thinking that as ISRO is one of the best organizations in India as far as the output is concerned, one of the things that stand out is that how ISRO deals with the political and bureaucratic interventions. Taking it up. So can you give some insight into that for example, there might be some interventions which might not be liked by the organization, how the organization deals with them? Because at different other organizations, it becomes a bit difficult at the leadership level as well as at the working level. So just an input from your side.
See, actually, bureaucracy does not always hinder you, really. It's not correct to say that. Because if you have told, for example, ISRO comes under Department of Space. Department of Space is directly under Prime Minister. Okay. So, we are under Prime Minister's office. We have to report to them. And, it is totally finance. It's not a private organization we are learning. We are trying to run there. It is a government institution. And government looks at our proposals and looks at the possibility of its application to the nation. And various factors will be there. And they need to approve and give the budget and all. And we have been successful in convincing them what is required. And I don't think, there has been a conflict or anything in the interest of the organization and the government anyway. I always consider myself as part of the government too, because how can, for example, in a family, your father is there and he may have certain interests which will not go well with you. Sometimes, for example, you go with a fantastic proposal and they tell no. So, I mean, you need to respect, because there is a broader view at the government, why or why not it can be taken up. You may have your own this one, and it all depends on how you put forward. So you must understand what is in the view of your bureaucratic setup, and how you can align with the bureaucratic setup and yet meet your dreams. So 100% you may not be able to always please, and you may not be able to get an acceptance, but at least if you are not able to do even 95%, then you are not doing your job properly. Okay, so bureaucracy is not bad. Bureaucracy is there because they have a larger vista, and they can see better as an overall country. And if any institution is having 50% conflict, then it is wrong. There is something wrong going on there. So fortunately in ISRO, we are aligned with the government policies, and also probably, space is something which is a matter of pride to the nation, and it's something, a niche area. And nowadays, of course, it is not remaining the same thing. A lot of private people are also taking up, etc. Now, further, we have to see what. But so far, we have been really fortunate that, our programs have run well. And on the flip side, if you see, whatever government entrusted on us, we were able to deliver. As I told in one of my slides, those things, innovations are required, results are required, so that we build confidence. Confidence building is required into the bureaucracy, and you are entrusted by telling that you have to do something, and you do it. So it's a positive feedback, and you keep on failing and it doesn't happen, then how will they have confidence? Because every project costs crores of rupees, and it is country's money. So we should have responsibility, and we should align with the, when I say bureaucracy, for me it is government and central government. So we have to align with the requirements of the nation, and we have to do that. Sometimes if we don't have, we have to try to convince them. We have done a lot. Last 2 years I spent my time in policy making and all that before my retirement, and I know I have faced it, because I had to be in the front and then explain. And I understood that when we were young, we would say, what is this? These people are not letting us do enough. So when you go up, you understand why you cannot do, and how you have to do, how you have to satisfy yourself and yet, meet with the overall goals of the nation, etc. So it's not a big thing. Organization can stay. It's not possible.
Yeah. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks a lot for this insight into it. And I think we will also be helping from it. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. If there is no other question, then may I please invite now Professor Archana Bhatnagar to deliver the vote of thanks, ma'am?
Yeah. If there are no more questions, I would like to thank ma'am, Dr. Anuradha, for accepting our invitation and then delivering this wonderful talk. It is so, so inspiring, ma'am. We can't tell you. And I think each one of us can relate with you. Of course, we haven't risen to that level. But as a woman scientist working in their respective fields, we've gone through the same, and we are working and trying to overcome all these things. And it's really more important for the my younger colleagues who have got into this science passion, and they feel whether they will be able to rise or not. I feel you have just hit on the right points. We can't be second to anyone. We have to keep our equanimity in place. We have to rise to whatever it takes, whether it's brickbats or bouquets. So it was lovely, ma'am. And would love to meet you in person. Would love to invite you again to our university as and when it is possible. And I think the pandemic has been very bad. But as far as our lectures are concerned, I would say that we have been able to shrink the world and get people from, you know, far off places. Otherwise, it would have taken you quite an effort to come take out time. So thank you for this talk. And we are certainly going to have you with us physically as and when possible, ma'am. That's a promise. And please do keep it for us. And I would also like to thank my husband, Sanjay Bhatnagar, who has been a scientist with Department of Space. He's been with Semiconductor Labs. And it was he who, when I was wondering whom to invite next, he said, why don't you call her? She's been the first woman director of in ISRO. Oh, I said, wow. So just as you said, you have your family beside you. It's the same with me. So always we are discussing.
Arshana ma'am, that credit now should be transferred to Sari.
He made it possible for us to bring Anuradha ma'am so close to us.
Right, absolutely.
And yes, I would like to thank Nishima for coordinating everything so beautifully. And the whole thing runs so smoothly when she takes charge of anything. I would like to thank our core members, Dr. Deepti Gupta, Dr. Jagdeep Kaur. Dr. Jagdeep could not join today with us. And Dr. Jayanti Datta. So all of us, though it's a teamwork, but everybody puts in their own share so that we do the best. And of course, nothing is possible if we don't have people to listen to it and then interact. So thanks to all the participants for their lovely contribution. And I would like to then close the meeting with a big thank you for everyone. And also this time, what is special is that Indian National Youth
Academy of Sciences.
Of Sciences has come together with us. Yeah. And that's a very good thing to happen. I want that the younger generation should take, you know, experiential learning is what we want to give to people. So thank you, ma'am, once again. Thanks to the team. Thank you to the participants. And that's it from here.
Thank you, ma'am.
It was a pleasure.
Pleasure is all ours.
Same here, ma'am.
Thank you. Okay, ma'am. Now formally close the meeting. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Bye. Okay. Bye-bye, ma'am.